just me. No disclosure, vicious myth. Confiscated evidence. No smoking gun. Public has a right to know.
Welcome back to the No Disclosure Podcast. Well, technically, this podcast isn't even called No Disclosure anymore, is it? It's called No Disclosure Weird News Weekly. There's a reason for that. Whenever I would, you know, because I want to hear every episode, like people would hear it in the wild, you know. So I would tell my Alexa or whatever device, hey, play No Disclosure. And then it'd play God knows what. And it would play something different every time. So I looked at all the weird news podcasts out there, my really awesome and talented competition. And all of them had at least, you know, what the podcast was somewhere in its name. So as an experiment, you know, I changed it to No Disclosure Weird News Weekly. And guess what? The discoverability isn't poo-poo anymore. So there you go. But I'm not going to call it No Disclosure Weird News. We're just going to keep saying No Disclosure because, you know, we've been doing this for 7 seasons. And apparently it takes me 7 whole seasons to realize that the discoverability was duty. This is from Gizmodo.com. That's a weird website name. It sounds like one of those failed handheld video game consoles back in the early 2000s. Like it should be sitting next to a GameCom somewhere collecting dust. Gizmodo. A pilot drew a penis in the sky and wrote, "See ya," during a 6-hour flight. You owe it to yourself to look at this radar footage. He drew a dong, a very well done dong, and wrote "see ya" inside the dong. That is beautiful. And you guys know the rule with No Disclosure. Whenever I see the word penis on an article heading, I don't care what it's about, we will read it. And the penis has not let us down yet. So that radar footage, you owe it to yourself to look at it. It said that artists are painstakingly dedicated to their craft, so I have no other option than to take off my imaginary hat for the pilot who toiled for 6 hours to draw a dick in the sky with the word "see ya" written in the shaft. The not-safe-for-work art, which is perfect for a NSFW podcast, created by a pilot flying a Diamond DA-42 plane and spotted by Flight Radar 24, an online flight tracking service. According to Flight Radar 24, the plane took off at 8:47 p.m. Saturday night, landed at 2:47 a.m. on this past Sunday at the Bellefontaine Regional Airport in Ohio. It's not yet clear who was piloting the thing, but the unknown artist is quickly developing a fan base online. Yes, sir/ma'am, more than likely a sir, because it's been sirs who have been drawing penises on things ever since the Roman Colosseum was built, and no, that's not a joke. Recently, they found a penis carved into the Roman Colosseum, apparently, and they found it on other things, too, and it had a striking similarity to other penises carved during the time. This isn't a recent penis. This is an old penis carved during the time on other historical parts. So they thought that there was, you know, more than likely a serial dong carver in ancient Rome. So boys will be boys. Doesn't matter what era it is. Welcome to No Disclosure. This podcast is brought to you by Asylum 817 Productions. I ran out of breath there. Asylum 817 Productions, Spotify, and DistroKid. This podcast is where we go on the news, see what's happening in the world, and based like fine expensive turkeys in the sheer audacity and craziness that is our news media. This is from Yahoo Finance. In my opinion, the two most boring words in the English language, Yahoo and finance put together. But hey, they got something for us today. BP manager's husband pleads guilty to insider trading after eavesdropping on his wife's conversations while they both worked from home. That's lovely. That's really good. The husband of a former manager at British oil and gas giant BP has pleaded guilty to insider trading after he took advantage of sharing a workspace with his now estranged wife. Yeah, I'd say you're estranged now. During the pandemic to net himself a nice, cool $1.8 million profit. Holy shit. Tyler Loudon is facing up to 5 years in jail, $250,000 fine, after secretly buying up shares in truck stop service Travel Centers of America, according to court documents, blah, 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 blah. Case that began as a husband trying to fraudulently make enough money so his wife could work less hectic hours. Aw, that's sweet. Has led to her being fired and the beginning of divorce proceedings. Well, your heart was in the right place, but at this point, I really don't blame her for divorcing you. You're an idiot. You're the kind of guy who wants to take his wife out for an unforgettable date. So you rob a bank, clear the lobby, and, you know, you just have a date in there. Jeez. A bit heavy-handed, don't you think? I mean, like many couples, 42-year-old Loudon, and his wife, why am I saying sorry for? Fuck you, Loudon. And his wife found themselves boxed together in the Houston home during COVID-19. Now, his wife started working in BP's mergers and acquisitions team, okay, just for some background. And she major deal. She was working in a team looking to land a $1 billion acquisition. It's tough work. Endless hours of scrutiny, interrogation of employees, constant anxiety, I can imagine. And then her biggest headache, little did she know, was sitting in the next room. They worked within 20 feet of each other at their Houston home. Bad idea already. You don't mix work and home, kids. You just don't do it. You don't do it. That's why you don't fuck coworkers. No, you don't do that. The potential conflict of interest is something millions of people have encountered daily since at-home orders came into force in 2020. Blah, blah, blah. Well, that's crazy. I think a lot of people are saying, you know, should you really divorce him? Is that that is a big deal because you fucked up her, you know, work history. You fucked up her reputation. Like, how the hell is she going to get a job now? You know what I mean? You're an idiot. This is from Daily. That's all I'm going to say. Usually I have some smart ass, you know, quippy thing to say or some musical number, you know, or something like that. Yeah, no musical number here. Well, I suppose I could make up one. I mean, it doesn't really call for a musical number. Musical numbers, you know, when I do them, they come up naturally. You know, I don't force them. But just for fun, we should force one. It happened in BP a long time ago. I left her and screwed up her job. Now she lives in Mexico. Stars and steel guitars and luscious lips as red as wine. Fucked up somebody's job and I believe that it was mine. It happened with BP. Without thinking twice, I left her and threw away the key to paradise. My dumb ass heart lost my sweetheart. Now she's divorcing my sorry ass. That went on way longer than it probably should. You know what? I don't care. All right? Musical numbers here. We haven't done one in a while. Like a legit musical number. And you don't hear those on comedy podcasts or weird news podcasts or anything like that. And anytime that I get to parody a Frank Sinatra song, I am balls in. So this is thedailybeast.com. This is from The Daily Beast. This is just sickening to me. Student toe-licking fundraiser. Again? Something weird happened in a school and teachers allowed it again? Sparks investigation into Oklahoma school. Well, I hope so. Students at Deer Creek High School. It happened. No, I'm not going to do that. Volunteered to participate in the stunt to raise funds. Yeah, we have another fundraiser where something, you know, borderline fucking sexual abuse. Borderline, you know, just sexual abuse, period. Happened in a school. The teachers are like, no one's going to find out about this. Yeah, they, you know, it's illegal to diddle kids and teachers are getting busted left and right for it now. So now they're, these fucking weirdos that are working at these schools are coming up with other means, aren't they? Like, remember the one where the students were giving lap dances to the fucking teachers? Not one teacher stood up and went, this is fucking weird. Not one. Now we have it happening again. Oklahoma High School is reportedly under investigation after students were filmed licking peanut butter off of people's toes as part of a fundraising event. Oh, Jesus Christ. Students between 9th and 12th grade, wow, at Deer Creek School volunteered on Thursday to participate in the uniquely unhygienic stunt. We'll just say, we'll put it that way. Oh my God, licking people's toes. Oh, that's gross. But I mean, looking at the video, this is just another way for these closeted fucking pedophiles who work in these schools to get their fucking jollies off. I guarantee it, because this shit has been happening a lot lately. And you've seen, you know, incidents of teachers banging their students is going way down. I wonder why. Because they're getting smart. Or, yeah, as smart as an idiot like that can be. Licking peanut butter off of toes. What? And naturally, it took a fucking parent to spark the, you know, to spark the investigation. The school released a statement saying that they had raised $152,000. Yeah, that's a lot of money. Yeah. Someone was fucking filming that, putting that shit on the dark web, weren't they? Not your average Joe coffee. That's who they raised it for. A restaurant chain that works with students and adults with intellectual, developmental, and physical disabilities. And then what, did not your average Joe, did they say anything about this? I don't give a shit how much money my business needs. If they're going to, you know, do that by filming kids doing sick shit like that, but I don't want your fucking money. Not like this. No one said shit. The school district also said that all students involved volunteered for the activities and signed up for the games they played ahead of time. That doesn't fucking matter. See, this just shows how stupid you are. It doesn't matter, idiots. The game itself was fucked up. Yeah, I know they signed up for it. So what are you saying? What are you guys saying? That, oh, we're absolved of any wrongdoing because the students knew that it was going to be like this and signed up for it? This is a lot of, seriously, this is why a lot of victims have a really hard time coming out and telling their fucking stories because of dumbass, you know, because of dumbass fucking places like yours. It's ridiculous. I've seen this a lot with schools lately. Where did all these fucking freaks come from? This is from NBC News. Woman dies after Brazilian butt lift procedure performed by a Miami doctor who wasn't allowed to operate. Cool. Someone gave Florida man a fake medical license. A Tennessee mother of five died after she had a Brazilian butt lift performed by a Miami doctor who was allegedly not allowed to operate on anybody, according to a lawsuit the woman's family filed. Oh my God. How did she die? I mean, you think, you know, if you think, yeah, it's surgery. Surgery is always risky, even if it's a back alley fucking thing in Guatemala where they give you rat turds instead of, you know, with seasoned salt instead of fucking antibiotics. But still, even though this guy probably wore shoes and washed his hands, unlike in Guatemala, even though I could get a nose job there for like $8. Pretty good deal. Anyway, I'm not going to go into that. When you think death, you don't automatically go to the butt. You know, that's not really a vital area. You know what I mean? But I'm just wondering how that happened. Maybe we'll learn. Erica Russell, 33, traveled to Seduction Cosmetic Center. I'm not victim blaming here. I'm not. Someone died thinking that they were getting, you know, an actual procedure done. That's sad. That's tragic. But you went into a place called Seduction Cosmetic Center for surgery. That's where you go away. Jesus Christ. Well, they have fucking Grimace as a mascot. Florida in June 2021 to undergo a major cosmetic fucking procedure. During the procedure, her doctor, God, thank, oh, that's fucking crazy. John Sampson punctured her lip. Oh, fuck me. During the procedure, her doctor, John Sampson, punctured her fucking liver, her bladder, and her intestines with a cannula, a tube primarily used for removing fluid from the body. Holy shit. So that thing that, you know, that thing that removes the fluid from, he punctured, listen to this, punctured her liver, her bladder, and her intestines. Oh, fuck. Damn. And naturally went into cardiac arrest and fucking died. The lawsuit says her cause of death was determined to be pulmonary fat emboli and bleeding due to liposuction and bilateral gluteal augmentation surgery. Oh, fuck me. That is crazy. Attorneys representing, he didn't even like do halfway good job. I mean, you know what I mean? Like, he didn't even half-ass it. He just fucked it up. Attorneys representing Russell's family said Samson was not allowed to perform surgical procedures at the facility and alleged that seduction provided Russell with falsified paperwork stating that he had plastic and cosmetic privileges at a local hospital when he did not. They also accused seduction of falsely marketing Samson as a surgeon performing surgery at its facility. Well, he kind of was, but... Is he a surgeon? No, that's where the lie was. I own a set of tools. Am I automatically a fucking carpenter? No. Oh, my God. That's fucking terrifying. So, yeah, my heart goes out to her family. That's terrible. It's tragic. Listen to me, okay? The name says a lot. And anybody worth their salt who runs any kind of business, whether it's a liposuction clinic or, you know, whatever, they know that the first impression is everything, right? And the marketability is everything, okay? If I open up an adult bookstore, and let's say my name is Victor DeLuise, I'm not going to open up VD's bookstore. Theater, $8 in the back. I'm not going to do that. Don't go into a place for cosmetic surgery called Seductions, okay? Jesus Christ. Well, I'm not victim blaming. That's horrible. I hope he gets his ass handed to him in court. Oh, wait, shit. No, that was a bad pun. Stop. I didn't mean to do it. Fuck. Okay, well, I'm really happy I don't cut on this show. Here we go. Phone calls. They're going to start back up again, aren't they? I managed to excise those people who got fucking butt hurt by everything I said and thought that I owed them some kind of an explanation out of my life. And here I am, kicking the dandelion. I'm going to start it back up again.
If you are a millennial woman and mommypreneur interested in building an unbreakable mental toolbox, then the PhD Mommy's Journey podcast is the podcast for you. This podcast explores the ABCs of millennial motherhood, female and woman entrepreneurship, personal growth, financial independence, and academic achievement. This podcast aims to educate and influence you to be the shero of your own story by being the best version of yourself every single day. It's time to put yourself first for once. You can do it. A link will be provided in this episode's description, so check it out.
This is from Unilad. Whenever I see Unilad, my brain, maybe I have a dyslexic moment or what. I'm not dyslexic, but my mom is severely dyslexic. But I have like a dyslexic moment. I want to say unlaid. That's perfect. It does. It looks like unlaid. Woman, 54, defends 21-year age gap with husband, claiming older men are boring and can't keep up. Jesus. Well... There you go. I mean, she's got the sex drive of a fucking rhinoceros. That's cool. Good for you. A Texas woman who found love, it happened, sorry, with a man 21 years her junior after claiming that she believes older gents to be rigid and boring. As a message to the older gents, you wanting yourself a cougar? Yeah, you better, you know, get your shit together. Mother of four, Michelle... said there was an instant attraction between herself and Brandon Graham, a truck driver and certified personal trainer. So I'm not going to say it. Before meeting her now husband, the 54-year-old had previously married to a man 11 years her senior. However, speaking about her past experience with older men, she said, "They couldn't keep up with me. They were just boring." This guy... looks like he's carved out of fucking granite. Yeah, personal trainer? Jeez, man. That guy's a tree trunk. Wow. After taking some time out for hunting for love, Ranilla met Graham, now 33, in September of 2019. Well, that's cool. Well, fuck it. Good for you. You're both adults. Who gives a shit? So she found him more handsome in real life compared to his photographs. There was an emotional attraction right off the bat. Oh, I'm sure there was. Look at this guy. He looks like fucking Adonis. That's man, that's cool, though. I mean, good for you. People are really railing her online for this, you know, the age gaps. Like, who gives a shit? You know what I mean? They're both adults. Is it her, really, or is it something else? Because I think it's something else. She's playing on, and she's exposing your insecurity. You know, when you get older, your body kind of goes to shit,
especially if you're in a relationship. You gain some weight, you get gout. You know,
you do. Your sex drive slows down. Mine? No. Mine does not slow down. Mine's gotten worse as I've gotten into my middle age. But, you know, I think she's just playing on your fucking insecurities here. She's exposing it, you know. Quit being a dried up, crusty old fart. And maybe your wife won't leave your ass for a 33-year-old personal trainer that looks like he was, you know, his mama was a fucking redwood. And his daddy was Arnold Schwarzenegger. I'm serious. Now, why are they giving her shit for it? That's great. Good for you. At least she didn't cheat on the guy. You know what I mean? She did things right. If you're miserable in a relationship, you need to fucking leave. Don't cheat. Don't feel like you're stuck. Don't any of that stuff. You're just doing yourself and the other person a disservice. You're unhappy in a relationship. Don't cheat on somebody. Get the fuck out. And then get with your personal fucking trainer. That's awesome. Fuck him. You do you, lady. Or you do him. This is from ABC News. Mother arrested after concocting drink for her son to give the school bully that sent him to the hospital. Wow. Jeez. That's not how you handle bullies, okay? Mom? The drink was non-toxic but did result in a child being hospitalized. Yeah, because bully or not, I mean, you're still dealing with a kid. This is not how you deal with bullying, okay? Teach the kid to defend themselves. You teach them, hey, this is what you do. You go to a teacher, you know, blah, blah, blah. You teach them whatever you got to teach them. You don't say, let's poison the bitch. A Texas mother's been arrested after a drink she made for her son's bully sent him to the hospital. Wow. Jennifer Lynn Rossi, 45. See, this is what makes me think, like, these are older people, some of these, who do shit like this. So I always get to thinking, how did you last 45 years, you know, having this kind of a brain, being this fucked up in the head? How did you last for 45 years out in the wild? I think this. And I'm dead serious about it, too. I legitimately wonder this. Do people just snap one day? Because, you know, obviously she's fucking crazy and thinks this is okay behavior. So she managed to last 45 years out in the fucking wild, you know, and then now she snaps? I'm genuinely curious as to what pushes people over that edge and why it takes so long. Okay, so you want to know what the drink is? Mix lemon juice, vinegar, salt, and Gatorade together in a sports bottle on Tuesday. Told her son to give it to a classmate who had stolen his drink the day before at Legacy Traditional School, Alamo Ranch, 20 miles northwest of downtown San Antonio, Texas. Wow, that was a sentence, guys. Damn, ABC. Don't you guys have proofreaders? According to an arrest warrant affidavit obtained by ABC News' San Antonio affiliate, baby. Upon arriving to the school, deputies learned that the sick child was given a drink by a classmate during PE class. Shortly after the child consumed the drink, he began experiencing nausea and a severe headache. So what was this again? Where's the fucking recipe? That was a bad word to use. What did she mix in it? This is a short article. Why can't I fucking find it? My God. Okay. Here it is. Jeez. Article's like, you know, 8 words and I can't find the fucking thing. Okay, lemon juice, vinegar, salt, and Gatorade together. Yeah, that's a recipe for some fucking diarrhea at least. Although the contents of the drink were non-toxic, the incident resulted in a child being hospitalized. Yeah. And was there bullying before this, or was this your reaction to just your kid having their drink stolen? I shudder to think what you would have done to this other child. Child, bully or not, what you would have done to this other child if they had really been railing on your kid. You know what I mean? Giving him a swirly and wedgies and fart blossom and making him kiss the, you know, sidewalk and all this. That would have been, then you would have been straight up fucking killed probably. Crazy. Good. Rotten jail. Fuck you, Rossi. Charged with injury to a child. Yeah. Yeah. That's no joke. That's a big one. This is from ABC, again, but this is ABC out of Australia, okay? We're not being repetitive here. Great Barrier Reef scuba diver reunites Victorian couple with a mobile phone that was lost at sea. Really? That's awesome. Wait, I want to hear about this. A Victorian couple have been reunited with their mobile phone 10 days after it was lost at sea during a snorkeling trip on the Great Barrier Reef. Damn. Diana and Alex Jara had been enjoying a Valentine's Day snorkel tour off the coast of Hook Island, a largely uninhabited and remote part of the Whitsundays when the trouble started. Husband dove in, scuba mask fell off, he dove in to get it, had a waterproof lanyard with his mobile phone. He retrieved the mask, but phone went bye-bye. It was unlikely hope it would one day be recovered, so they activated a lost phone message, shared their contact details on the home screen. So, yeah. They sent that phone a message because it was in a waterproof container. They sent that phone a message giving whoever found it, whether it be somebody who else is vacationing a few days, years, you know, decades later, or whenever our, you know, the heat death of the fucking universe and aliens come here just to see, you know, what the place used to be like, or study this fucker, this dried husk of a planet that Earth used to be. And they find this thing. And they managed to power it up. So thankfully, we didn't have to wait until the heat death of the universe. So yeah, this dude. Wait, what is this? Okay. Was it a dude or a chick? I don't want to be inaccurate here. Okay. Arleigh Beach resident Carla Dobson. See? It ended up being a woman. I'm an idiot. Was on her first dive since gaining her scuba license. This was your first dive, too? That's awesome. She spotted an object on the seafloor about 15 meters below the surface. She said poor weather forced the tour group to dive on the northern side of the island, which was more protected. So, yeah, she said the phone definitely looked out of place. It was in a waterproof container. She saw the emergency message, called Miss Jara. That's fucking awesome. Ooh. Oh, that was a good one. Miss Jara received the phone back this week, this past week. When you listen to it, it'll be 2 weeks ago. And said it was full of precious photos from their Queensland holiday and one with their one-year-old granddaughter. It was just about these little memories of her meeting the Warner Brothers characters at Movie World. I mean, all of those were gone. Ms. Dobson has put the discovery down to a stroke of good fortune. I would say on your first dive, that's amazing. The ocean is so big. It could have been 10 meters off to the left of it. 10 meters off to the right, left, you would have never noticed it. That is amazing. I like stories like that. See, it's not all musical numbers, Florida man, belches, and complaining about people that get fucking butt hurt all the time. See, we do some human interest stories every once in a while, too. You know what I mean? Speaking of human interest, balls out bowling. Yeah, that's a thing. And it is exactly what you think it is. This is from WTRF.com. Balls out bowling is back where nudity is a requirement. Yes, nude bowling. I want to go. This is awesome. I think every bowling alley should host a nude event. Man, the fucking money that you would rack in? That's crazy. Balls Out Bowling, what a great name. It's back for the ultimate bowling experience. Pittsburgh area naturalists are hosting another Balls Out Bowling event where you could bowl completely naked. Balls Out Bowling will be held at the Crafton Ingram Lanes in Pittsburgh, PA, Sunday, April 28th, in case you want to go. The event is for anyone over the age of 18, whether you're a seasoned pro or a beginner. This event is for everybody. Nudity is required, with the exception that women can wear bottoms if they want to. Also, sexual activity is not permitted. What happens if you get a boner? What's boner etiquette? Because they never explained this. You know what I mean? They have the cojones to do something in the nude, some kind of event or, you know, game or something like this, but they don't tell you boner etiquette. Will there be a sign, a rope, you know, some kind of handout when you walk in the door? What do you do? Do you tape it to your leg? What? Those running the event say nudism does not equal consent and harassment will not be taken lightly. Violators will be asked to leave. No photography or video is allowed. And the event is a ticket event. It's like, well, I wear glasses. And they're like, well, those are pretty thick-looking glasses. I know. I got really bad vision. Here, stand here for a second while I focus. I mean, adjust my glasses. No, I wouldn't do that. That's that's a terrible joke. But, yeah, well, that's, you know, don't film people when they... when they don't know they're being filmed, especially at a nudist event. I've never been to a nudist event. That would be fun. I'm not self-conscious about my body whatsoever, even though my body is completely embarrassing to look at. I'm built like a manatee. I have gynecomastia. I don't give a shit. I've always had that, you know, I was part of the body positivity movement before anybody knew what the body positivity movement was. I've just always had that kind of confidence about me. I would love to go to a place like that. That's great. No tickets will be sold at the door. Damn it. More information on the event can be found here. Tickets for the event can be found here. Let's go to their website, and I want to find out about boner etiquette. They're not going to say it, are they? Damn it! They never know. Invite friends willing to get naked. I like this. They have their own Facebook page. This is cool. I want to go. Damn it. I don't live close to PA, though. Shit. That'd be so much fun. Balls out bowling. You see what I'm talking about? See what I'm talking about? Smart businesses, names, huh? Having your shit together. That's smart. That's where you want a cheeky name. Not if you're running some kind of back alley surgery like the 1989 fucking Batman film. You know what I mean? This is how you name stuff. This is a smart one. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that's all we got. We're out of time. That's all, friends. Special thanks to this week's sponsors who make the show possible. Head to asylum817.com. That's asylum817.com to check out all things No Disclosure and all my other artistic ventures. Make sure to also check out the link to our Patreon page in this episode's description, where as little as a dollar a month, you can get everything from bonus episodes, ad-free episodes, giveaways of certain tiers, outtakes, bloopers, a podcast just for the patrons. I don't know who's fucking mad enough to do that, but I am. Special thanks to the patrons, by the way. The Kunkel Homestead YouTube channel, Donald Haynes, Dilligaff, I appreciate all of you. Thank you for coming back. That's all we got, okay? Huh? Bye-bye, my babies. I love you all. And be fancy. Yeah! Who wants to do balls out bowling with me? That sounded really bad.
Did you know it's the faces here? No disclosure, faces missed. Confiscated evidence, no smoking gun. Public has a right to vote.